My name is Mary Konsolaki. I am in the Department of Genetics and the Human Genetics Institute. My research topic is Alzheimer's disease. Alzheimer's has been studied for over 100 years now. From 1906, the disease was first discovered. Unfortunately, we know a lot of things about the mechanism of the disease, but we don't have a lot of approaches to address what happens, which is unfortunate because the incidence of Alzheimer's disease is increasing in the population. This is because the highest risk factor of developing the disease is age. So the longer one lives, the more chance that they will develop the disease. And since our lifespan increases, especially more rapidly so in developed societies, there is an increasing risk that more and more people will get the disease. We study the molecular pathways that lead to Alzheimer's using a model system, which is Drosophila melanogaster, basically a fruit fly. You would think that it is a little strange that you would use flies to study human disease. However, flies have really all the systems and organs that we humans have. They have a nervous system, they have a digestive system, they have a circulatory system, immune system. The genes that regulate these processes in the flies are really very similar to the genes that do the same things in humans. For basic molecular pathways, for basic biochemistry, let's say, of our body, we can use the fly to understand what is going on. And the fly is an easy organism to use because they have a very short generation time. You can go from one generation to another in a couple of weeks. So it's a great system to do genetics. The flies develop what we call symptoms and manifestations of the disease, such as they have learning and memory issues. And we have behavioral assays where we can test that in the flies. They also develop plaques. Plaque is a material that is deposited. It's a protein-based material that is deposited in the brain of people who have Alzheimer's disease. When we express the disease genes in flies, they also develop these plaques in their brain. They also have degeneration of the brain. So if you dissect the brains and you look at them, they have holes where the tissue is missing. So we can take these flies then and introduce mutations in genes that we candidate genes that we may think that there is a reason to believe that they have something to do with Alzheimer's. And we can see how these manifestations of the disease are altered in the flies. For example, do they get better if we put this mutation? Do they have normal lifespan? Do they have less deposition of amyloid? So now we have these flies that express Alzheimer's genes and they have symptoms and manifestations, phenotypes of the disease. So what do we do with them? We can test for the involvement of mutations in other genes that we have a reason to suspect or we want to test anyway to see whether they would play a role in the development of Alzheimer's disease. And that's indeed what we have done, introduced these mutations to the Alzheimer's flies, and then we can look at the phenotypes again and say, okay, do they live a longer life? Do they have less beta amyloid? Do they have better locomotion? Locomotion is another phenotype that is affected. And then we can make a conclusion as to these new genes and mutations about their potential role in Alzheimer's. So we can say, oh, so these copper genes, if we mutate them, they make the phenotype worse. So that means that the regulation of copper trafficking in the cell or in the brain plays a role in Alzheimer's. The availability of these models that I was able to develop several years ago has made it possible now to, first of all, give these flies to a whole bunch of other labs where they have used them in their studies. And indeed, there's been in the last 8-9 years, there's been way over 100 labs that have asked me for these flies. I have collaborated with a colleague at New Jersey Medical School, Ray Burge, on the role of copper transporters in Alzheimer's. Copper is a heavy metal. Interestingly, we have heavy metals in our body that we really take from the food. that we ingest. And they play a role, an important role actually, in our, the function of our nervous system. And we found in this collaboration that the proteins that are responsible for the distribution and the transport of copper in and out of our neurons are actually involved also in Alzheimer's disease. In addition to that, another project that is currently going on is a collaboration with REHS and the pharmacology department here, with Dr. Ken Rule and Dr. Jason Richardson. We study the role of pesticides, the potential role of pesticides on Alzheimer's disease. Unfortunately, there's therapies that are in clinical trials, there's immunization is a potential therapy, but we, even after all these years, we don't have something that will change the course of the disease. What we have achieved so far is to delay, basically, the development of the symptoms, but we don't have therapies right now that will reverse the course. The last couple of years, my lab has been all undergraduates working on these Alzheimer's projects that I described, and they have been, every undergraduate stays for a short time, but some of them, when they start early, they get to be here for 2-3 years sometimes, and that is enough time to build a project and get some results. So they have indeed been part of publications. The long run hope of the project, of course, is to find targets, either to find drugs that might help in Alzheimer's, or to find target what we call drug targets, basically a protein that can be targeted with a pharmaceutical. That when you do that, you can improve the prognosis, let's say, or the outcome of Alzheimer's. This is a very long goal, of course, but that's what the goal is, and that's what my undergraduate students have to think of as the long-term goal of the project.